Hi, welcome to the lecture on pointers in C. Let us start this lecture with a discussion on memory allocation and access. The purpose of this session is to see how memory is allocated for variables in a program, and during the execution how the variables are accessed from memory. So in this example, there is a function main which creates three variables A, B and C of type unsigned. Let us see how the execution progresses in this program. This blue arrow represents that the function main is invoked for execution, and as a result an instance of the function main is created where the variables A, B and C are getting memory allocated. Consider the variable A, which is an unsigned integer. So 2 bytes of memory is required for an unsigned integer, that is our assumption. And in this figure it shows that 2 bytes, 500 and 501 are allocated for the variable A, and I call these 2 bytes as a location. So in this lecture, whenever I say location, I mean a consecutive sequence of bytes to store the value of a variable. So here A requires 2 bytes, and these 2 bytes is called the location for A, and the address of the location for A is 500. So similarly, B and C are getting locations allocated, and the function can access a memory location, say for A, through the stack. It goes to the stack, and through the stack it goes to the location and access the memory. Let's see how the execution progresses. First, the control comes to the executable statement A is equal to 10, that is the value 10 needs to be assigned into the variable A. Where is A allocated? It's in memory. So the system goes to the memory through the stack. It goes and finds that address is the location is here, and it stores the value 10 in that location. Next statement is B is equal to 20. So 20 needs to be assigned in B. So the system goes to the location for B through the stack. Yes, it finds that the location address is 502, and it assigns 20 there. And it comes to the last statement where the RHS is a sub-expression where it needs to find the sum of 2 variables. So it needs to go to the locations for A and B. It goes through the stack. It finds that the locations are 502. It reads the values and finds the sum of these two, that is 30, and it remembers it in the CPU, and then it needs to assign it to the location for C. So through the stack it finds the location for C, that is 508, and it assigns the result, which is 30 there. Okay. So let us recollect what we did. When a function is invoked for execution, an instance of it is created in memory. An instance of a function in memory includes the locations allocated for its variables. Other than this, it includes the code, etc. But we don't have to consider that for the purpose of discussing pointers. A function can access a variable's location in memory through what is called a system stack. During the execution of a program, the system stack will contain a separate entry for each of the active function instances. For example, consider a program which starts its execution with the main function. So the system stack shows that, okay, now the main is invoked and it's active in execution. The main is executing. Okay, suppose the main which now this main is having three variables A, B and C, and that is why this tag shows A, B and C. Suppose main calls another function, say foo, then an instance of foo will be created in the stack, then the stack shows that M and N are the variable in foo. And suppose foo in turn makes a call to another function bar, then an instance of bar is created in memory. As it shows, there are four variables I, J, X and Y. So now the currently executing function is bar. When bar finishes, it returns to foo, and when it returns, the instance of bar will be deleted from the stack. Okay, and then foo will also finish eventually and returns to main. So the foo instance will be deleted, and finally main will also finish its execution, and thus the program completes its execution. This is just to show how stack is growing and shrinking during the execution of a program. And the currently executing function instance will be on the top of the stack. Okay, let us move on to another example. And here the purpose is to see how variables are allocated in memory when there are more than one functions. So here in this example, there are two functions, the main function and the swap function. And what the swap function is doing is, it takes two integer arguments and it just interchange the values in the variables A and B. If you give 10 and 20 in A and B, then it gives you 20 in A and 10 in B. That is the purpose of this function. And this is a motivating example to study pointers, and let us see what will happen when you run these programs. That what main is trying to do is, it declares two integer variables A and B and assigns 10 and 20 to it as a part of declaration itself, and then it makes the swap function to interchange the values of A and B. So naturally, after that, the user or the programmer wants to see that the values are interchanged. Okay, and an interesting point in this program is that both the function swap and main make use of variables A and B. Both these functions are having the variable names A and B. Let us see how this is managed and how the execution progresses in this example. So the main function is invoked. So two variables are created, only two variables are there, A and B, getting these locations, and getting this initialization also, initial values are assigned. And the execution comes to this statement, which is a function call. And see how the function call is implemented, and the function call happened. So as you know, an instance of swap needs to be created. How many variables are there in swap? Three, A, B, and C. So see, new instance is created, new instance of swap is created in the stack, and three variables are there. And see that these three variables are having separate memory locations allocated. So A in swap is not same as the A in main, and that is why it needs a data structure like stack. If swap is in execution, then A means this A. Okay, and if main is in execution, then A means this A, and that is it. And when you look at how the execution progresses, it will be very clear. So here an important point that you have to remember is how the variables are passed. Okay, it's called pass by value. That is, new variables are created in the called function. Here the called function is swap. New variables are created. If you want, you can use the names A and B, doesn't matter. You can also say X and Y. These are just variable names. So new variables are created in the memory, and values are copied from the calling function. So actually from the memory for variables in main, the values 10 and 20 are copied into the new locations for the swap function. Let us see how the execution progresses. It comes to the first assignment statement, the RHS is A. So it needs to read the value of A from the memory. Through the stack, it finds that swap is having an A. It goes to A of the swap function and reads 10 and stores in the CPU. And then it needs to assign that 10 to the location for C. And C of swap function through the swap main of instance of swap in the stack, it goes and finds that the location is here, and so it assigns the value 10 in that location, stores the value in that location. Then the control comes to the next statement. So it first finds the reads the value of B from the memory through the stack. If it gets 20, and then it stores the value 20 in the location for A through the stack. Yes. And it comes to the last statement where the RHS is a variable C. So it needs to read the value from the location for C. Through the stack, it finds the location for C and the value is 10. It is taken to the CPU, and that 10 needs to be assigned to the location for B. It goes to the location for B through the stack and stores the value 10 in that location. So the execution of swap is completed, so the control needs to return. It returned to the calling part, which is the main function here. See that because the instance is deleted and stack instance is deleted, so this part of the memory is not accessible to the program now. So whatever you have done in this part of the memory is not accessible to the calling function main. So it comes to the printf statement, and the printf statement tries to print A and B. So through the stack, it goes and finds the values of A and B, 10 and 20, and it prints the value. See, it just prints 10 and 20 only. The swap effect is not visible or not accessible to the main function. So the question now is, if you go back to this state of the program, then how can we interchange the values using the swap function? If you want to interchange using a function, how will you do it? One solution is you let swap function to directly modify the variables of the main function at location 500 and 502. If you allow the swap function to directly interchange the value in these locations, then that will be okay. And which is possible with what are called pointers. So we can pass, if you are using pointers, you can pass the addresses of A and B. See here, you can pass the addresses of A and B, ampersand A and ampersand B, into the call function. Okay, but you cannot just have an integer variable, because what you want to receive is not an integer value but an address of a memory location. So you need something else here, basically what? Pointer. Yes, and here you need to access the values of A and B through pointers. Okay, that we will see after we study pointers. So with this as a motivating example to study pointers in C, let us move on to the topic pointers in C. So the requirement for this swap function, as a motivation, we can see what are pointers in C. So here is an example, and example program, and the purpose is just to explain what a pointer is. So here an important part of this program is this. So here you say that unsigned star PV. So the star is the only new thing. And what it says, it's called an asterisk. This operator, when it's used in a declaration statement, is called an asterisk. And its purpose is just to specify that PV is a pointer variable. Okay. Without star, PV is an ordinary variable. The only purpose of star, which is asterisk operator, is to specify that whatever follows is the name of a pointer variable. Okay, the next interesting thing is this, which you already know. This is ampersand operator to access the address of a variable. So this represents the address of the location for B. And third interesting thing is here, and this star is called indirection operator to access the content of the memory location pointed to by the pointer variable. So don't worry about these stars, and which will be very clear when we look at how the execution progresses. Let us see how the execution progresses. Main is involved. So here I am not showing the stack, but stack is there. Okay, I am not showing it, but it's there. So the variables in this program are V, which is an ordinary variable, and PV, which is a pointer variable because of this asterisk. And here I have an assumption that the pointer variable also requires 2 bytes. So a location for pointer variable is also 2 bytes. That is just an assumption. Okay, so let us see how the execution goes. It comes to the first executable statement, and what it gets is in the RHS, it is ampersand V. And what is ampersand V? That is, it needs to find the address of the location for B. It goes to the memory through the stack, and it finds that the address of the location for B is 500. So it gets 500 to the CPU, and then it needs to assign 500 to the variable PV, pointer variable PV. So it goes to the memory for PV. In that location, it assigns 500. And see, that is what you can assign to a pointer variable. A pointer variable can store the address of a memory location. Okay, any pointer variable can store the address of a memory location. So if you declare a pointer variable, what you can store in the location for the pointer variable is the address of a memory location. Okay, if you declare an unsigned variable like V, like this, then you can store an unsigned value in the location for B, here, 10. And if you declare a pointer variable like PV, using star PV, then in the location for PV, what you can store is the address of a memory location. So, any of this address, you can solve here. Okay, and now what is the data type of the pointer variable? The data type tells that in this address, if you store 500, then in the location 500, the value must be unsigned. So that is the data type of the pointer. That means data type of the pointer tells what type of value can be stored in a memory location, whose address is stored in the pointer variable. So that is the data type of a pointer variable. Okay, now the execution comes to the printf statement, and see the screen what is printed. It prints that ampersand V is 500. Is that correct? Yes, the address, the location for V is this, and the address is 500. So that is correct. Then it also tells that PV is 500. Is that correct? Yes, it's correct, because we assign the address of B, which is 500, to PV. So PV is 500, or PV, if we just access PV, you can see it from the memory location that it is 500. So that's correct. Then it execute this printf statement. So line, new line will print it, so it comes to the next line, and then it gets into the last printf statement and prints this. V is 10. Is that correct? Yes, because it goes to the address for V through the sack, and V, the location contains 10. So V is 10, that's fine. Is RPV 10? That's a more interesting thing here. RPV is 10. And how is it that? So what is PV? So PV is 500. So if you don't have this star, then just PV is 500. That is clear. That's even clear from this printf. And what is RPV? RPV tells that you go and access the value of the location PV, that is 500. Then use it as a memory address and go and read that value. Okay. So that's it. Okay. So it tells you that you first go and read the value of PV. What is it? It's 500. So RPV means use 500 and as a memory address, go to it and read 10. Okay, that's it. So when you say RPV, it reads PV first, so it gets 500, and using 500 as a memory address, it reads the value from there. So when you say RPV, two memory accesses are required, or two memory read is required. First is read the value of PV, which is 500, and use that as a memory address and read its content. Okay, that's it. So that is what is known as an indirection operator. There is a memory indirection. Read the value of PV, 500, use it as an address and read the value from that location. So that is RPV. I hope that is clear. Let's proceed. So a pointer variable is a variable representing the address of a memory location. An ordinary variable, say of type unsigned, can represent a value of type unsigned. For example, unsigned V tells that V is a variable which can store a, or which can represent a value of type unsigned. On the other hand, PV is declared as a pointer variable, which tells that PV can represent the address of a memory location. What is this unsigned saying then? If PV represents the memory location 500, then at 500 you can have a unsigned value, and that is this unsigned. Okay, so that's it. Now consider this expression. V is an ordinary variable of type unsigned, and what's the value now? 10. So what will be V plus 1? 11. Yes, correct. Then what will be this? This is interesting. So what is PV now? The PV contains the value 500. So what will be PV plus 1? If it is the same plus operator, it must be 501. But it is not 501. It is 502. Why? Because PV plus 1 is just a symbolic representation which represents the address of the second unsigned integer from the location represented by PV. What is the location represented by PV? It's 500. And what is the first integer stored unsigned? It is 10. So what will be the second integer stored? It will be in this location. And what is the address? It is 502. And that is why it is 502. Anyway, that will be very clear when we complete the discussion on pointers. Let us proceed. So here is the syntax for declaring a pointer variable. So you have the data type, which is the type of value that you can store in the location whose address is stored in the pointer variable. And then this is the asterisk to specify that this is a pointer variable, and then the name of the pointer variable. And next is the syntax to access a point value through a pointer variable using the indirection operator. So this is the indirection operator, which tells that you use the value of pointer variable as an address and read the value from that address. And then the pointer variable and the expression as a whole represents the value stored at a location whose address is in the pointer variable. Okay. So now we can see which are the different kinds of assignments possible to a pointer variable. Here, what it do is it declares an ordinary variable v of type integer and its value is 10, and a pointer variable it is assigned to store the address of v, which is 500. Yes. So you can store the address of another variable to a pointer variable provided both pv and v are having the same data type. Okay, and the second possible assignment is this. Here, this is the interesting statement. So, in this example, you are having three variables. One ordinary variable v is allocated here, value is 10, and then two pointer variables. This statement says that you assign the address of the variable v, which is 500, to p1b. Okay, that's why it's 500. Then this is the interesting statement which tells that you assign the value of the other pointer variable to it. That means after this assignment, both p1v and p2v will point to the same memory location. And sometimes they are called alias names. Both p1v and p2v are pointing to the same memory location, which is this. Okay, two pointers are now there to 500, which is p1v and p2b. So you can assign the value of another pointer variable provided both these pointer variables are of the same data type. And the third kind of an assignment is, here you have an array of 5 elements, and if you execute array of 5 elements is created in memory and a pointer variable, and the pointer variable can take the address of any memory location where an integer is stored. So it is just taking the address of the second the integer stored at index 2. So what is the address? 504. It is stored here. Okay, so this tells you that you can assign the address of an arbitrary element in an array provided the array and the pointer are having the same data type. Okay, that is the third kind of assignment. The fourth kind of assignment is, here is it's also very interesting. You can assign the This is the interesting statement. So here I declared a pointer, which is a pointer to a function, which takes an integer argument and returns nothing. Yes. Okay. So you can ask to this variable, you can assign the address of a function, any function, which takes an integer argument and returns nothing, no explicit return, it's void. Okay. So here what I do is, there is a function foo which takes an integer argument and returns nothing. So you can assign the address of foo. Okay, so you if you just say foo also, it is the address. Okay, so let us see how it processes. And when a program is executed as a part of an instance, it also includes the executable code of that function, which also is stored in the memory. Now assume that foo is stored in this part of the memory and bar is stored in this part of the memory. So what is the address of foo? Address of foo starts with 500. So it says that in the pointer you store the address of foo, which is 500, and that is why 500 is there. So you can assign the address of a function also in a pointer, provided it's declared as a function pointer with the required argument and return value. Okay, and this is the last assignment, where this statement tells that you can assign the value 0. But here you have to note that this is not assigning the numeric value 0, but a programmer may need to use it if he cannot assign the address of a valid location until it reaches a specific point in the program. Okay, this is just an initialization, and it will be used only for checking that pointer variable is valid or not. When you access a memory location through a pointer like star PV, you know, we saw that when PV is containing the address 500, star PV means the content of the location 500. Okay, so first accessing a location through star PV, it is what is called memory dereference using a pointer. What is it called? Memory dereference. And to dereference a memory through a pointer using the indirection operator, the pointer must not be null. Okay, so it is better if then whenever you access a memory through pointer, you check that the pointer is non-null. If PV is not equal to null, then you access memory. Okay, only to enable such a checking, you can assign null. Null is basically zero to a pointer. Okay, it will be clear when you start doing programming with pointers in it, in your program. Okay. So we have finished the first two topics. That is, the first was memory allocation for variables, and the second is pointers in C, the basics of pointers in C. And let us move on to the next topic, which is pointers for parameter passing. So this is the same example where we need to swap two values using the function swap. And here the only difference is that rather than passing just A and B, here we pass the address of A and address of B. How the execution progresses? So the main is invoked. So an instance of main is created in the stack. Only two variables, A and B, are getting these locations allocated. So here is a function call. See how the function call happens. So the swap is invoked. So an instance of swap is created in the stack. So which are the variables? PA, PB, and C. PA is a pointer variable because of this asterisk, and PB is again a pointer variable. And you see that what is passed to PA is address of A. So what is the address of A? Address of a memory location. So here you must have a pointer variable, because what you are passing is the address of a memory location, and in C, the only variable which allows you to store a memory address is pointer variable. So this must be a pointer variable. Here again, because you are passing the address of B, it must be a pointer variable. So what is passed to PA? The address of A, what is it? 500. So PA now contains 500. Similarly, PB contains the address of B, which is 502. And C is not initialized, so the value is unknown. Okay, so this is what is called pass by address. So pointer variables get addresses of the variables in the calling function. Here it gets the addresses of A and B. So variables in the calling function, that is main, is shared with the call function, because the call function, which is swap, now can access the value of A. How? Through the pointer PA. If it says star PA, what is it? Read PA, which is 500, use it as an address and go to 500 and access its value. Okay, what is the value? It's actually the value of the variable A in which program? In the main program. Yes. Thus, through pointers, you are getting a chance to share the variables of the main program with the swap function, of the main function with the swap function. Let us see how the program execution progresses. It comes to the first statement. Here it says C is equal to star PA. So you know what is star PA. What is it? You first go and access the value of PA through the stack. What is the value? It's 500. Take the value 500. It's in the CPU. And it then says star of 500. What is star of 500? Means you go to 500 and take and read its value. What is the value? 10. So that star 500 is replaced with the 10. And now the statement wants the system to assign 10 to the location for C. So through the stack, it goes to the location for C and it assigns 10 in that location. And then it progresses to the next statement. What is the RHS? RHS is star PV. So first, it needs to read the value of PV. What is it? Through the stack, it finds that this is the location and 500 is read. Sorry, not 500. What is it? PV is 502. 502 is read and is taken here. And what is next? Star 502. So what is it? Jump to 502 and take the value from there. What is it? 20. So 20 is now there in the CPU. It needs to be assigned to, yes, star PA. Interesting. In the LHS is not just PA. It is star PA. So where you have to store? Not in the location for PA, but in the location whose address is stored in PA. So first go to PA. The location for PA in the memory, it's 500, and take that address and then star 500. That means you jump into 500 and store this temporary result. What is it? 20 in the address 500. And it proceeds to the last statement. RHS is C. Through the stack, it goes and finds the location for C. The value is 10. It is taken. And it needs to be assigned into a location point by PV. So it goes to PV through the stack and it is 502. It is 502, and then because star 502, it needs to jump into 502 and it stores the value 10 in that location. So the swap function finished executing all its statement and it just returns then to the calling part, which is the main function. See that the instance of stack is deleted, is not accessible now to the main function, and it comes to the last statement. So it needs to print the values of A and B. Through the stack, it goes and finds the locations and reads the value. What is the value of A? 20. B? 10. Yes, it prints the value. Yeah, that is what we wanted. So recall that now you are getting an opportunity to pass the address of variables from the main to the swap function, and it receives the addresses in pointer variables, and through the pointer variable you can manipulate the values in the memory locations allocated for the main function. Yes. So passing pointers as arguments to a function. Three different names are there for this. You can say pass by reference, or pass by location, or pass by address. Okay, these are three synonyms used for this parameter passing mechanism. Anyway, whatever be the name, what you are passing is the address of the memory location for the variable. Okay. So this enables the called function in the previous example is swap, to access and modify the variables in the calling function. In the previous example, main. So swap is getting modification access on the variables of main, and which can be exploited or utilized to implement the effect of returning multiple values from a function. Or you can say that in effect, you have returned the values for both A and B, right? Because A and B are interchanged from 10 and 20 to 20 and 10. And that interchange is reflected in the main function also. So it is like returning multiple values. So if you want to return multiple values from a function, what you can do is, suppose you want to return multiple values from a function foo to the function main. So what you can do is, You declare variables in the main function itself and pass the addresses of these variables to foo. And foo can receive those variable addresses in pointers and then change the values of the variables in the main function from inside foo. That is what you can do. And that is what we did also in this swap function. And with this, I am giving you an exercise. So, write a function to find the following counts from a sentence in English. So, you have to write a function which needs to take an English sentence as an argument and of course other addresses as arguments, and you have to find this number of vowels, number of consonants, number of digits, number of white spaces and number of the remaining symbols. So, within the function, you have to find all this and you have to print the counts from the main function. So, use pointers and see how can you do this. And with that, we can move on to the next section. So, we have now finished discussing the pointers in C, and we saw how pointers can be used to implement pass by reference. Okay, the purpose of this session is to understand the connection between one-dimensional arrays and pointers in C. So, here is an example program. And so, what this program is doing is, it's having an array. So, it's invoked. How many variables are there? There are two. One is an array of five elements, ARR of five elements is created. And a point, an index value, which is I is an unsigned integer, which is to index into the array. Okay. And I'm saying ARR plus I. And what is ARR plus I? It represents the address of the element at index I in the array. That is, ARR plus I is nothing but ampersand ARR I. So, using pointer also you can access the address of the I, element at index I. So, what is it? You can either, using the array notation, you know that it is ampersand ARR I. Using pointer notation, the same can be represented by ARR plus I. Okay, so that is a pointer notation. See, what I said is ARR plus I, if I is equal to 0, it is the starting address of the array. If I is equal to 1, it is the address of the element at index 1. What is it? 502. If I is equal to 2, it is the address of the element at index 2. It is 504. 3, the address of the element at index 3, which is 506. I is 4, then ARR plus I is address of the element at index 4, the address of the location is 508. That's what I mean. Let us see how the execution progresses. If you execute this statement, this message will be printed. So, you know that ARR plus I is nothing but the address of the element at index I. So, what this code is doing is reading five numbers, is trying to read five numbers and stores it in ARR 0, 1, 2, 3 and 4. If you read this, keep these values, then when you finish executing this program, all these values will be stored. And I has become 5. Okay. So, the purpose is just to see the connection between a one-dimensional array and pointer. Okay. So, if you declare a one-dimensional array like this, then what you are actually doing is you are creating a pointer constant, namely ARR. Okay. So, what is ARR? ARR points to the first element of the array. What is it? 500. So, ARR will be the first the address of the first element in the array. First element means at index 0. Okay. So when I say pointer constant, I mean the following. The value of arr cannot be changed. Means, can you do this? So what is this? Can I assign the address of, say, an arbitrary integer to arr? No, that is what I mean when I say it's a pointer constant. It's a pointer constant which always represents the, yes, address of the element at index 0. It always represents that address. You cannot alter it. Arr means the address of the first element. You cannot assign any value, or you cannot change the value of this pointer, and that is why it's called a pointer constant. So the relationship between a one-dimensional array and pointer is that the array name is a pointer constant. Yes, that's it. So the purpose of this slide is to understand what is ptr plus I when ptr is a pointer variable or pointer constant. Ptr can be a pointer variable or it can be the name of an array, it doesn't matter. Whatever it may be a pointer constant or pointer variable. Then what is ptr plus I? To understand what it is, let us look at an example first. So in this example, what we do, we created an array of size 6 unsigned integers. So an array of size 6 is created. The pointer variable is not shown in memory, not required for this discussion. And so this is the array created. So what I am assigning to ptr, I am assigning the address of the element at index 2. So what is the address of the element at index 2? Is 504. So what is ptr? Ptr is 504. Okay, so ptr plus, now see what is ptr plus 0. That means 504 itself. So that is the address of the element at 0. What is ptr plus 1, which is the address of the element at index 1? What is it? 500. So what you are assigning into ptr is the address of the element at 2. So what is ptr? Ptr is a pointer variable. So it need not be the address of the first element in the array. It can be the address of any element. So you assign the address of the second element to ptr. So what is it? 504. So what is ptr plus I? That means the element which is I locations away from 504. I is 0 here means 0 locations away. That means 504 itself. So ptr plus 1 means the element which is 1 location away from ptr. What is ptr? 504. So 504 is this location. 1 location away means this location. So what is the address? 506. Ptr plus 2 means 2 locations away from ptr. What is ptr? Ptr is 504. This is the first location. This is the second location. So 2 locations away means this address 508. And ptr plus 3 is 3 locations away. This is the first location, second location, third location. So 3 locations away means 510. Okay. So ptr plus I represents the address of the element which is I locations away from ptr. What is the location? Number of bytes required to store a value. Okay, if unsigned, then 2 bytes. To make it more clear, consider another example. Here there is a change. I declared a floating point array of 3 elements. So assumption is that a floating point value requires 4 bytes. So array at 0 requires 4 bytes. Array at 1 requires 4 bytes and array at 2 requires 4 bytes. So and what is assigned is the starting address of the array. So what is it? 500. What is PTR plus 0? 0 locations away. That is this location itself. What is PTR plus 1? 1 location away. So the first location is 4 bytes. So 1 location away means after 4 bytes. So what is it? 504. So what will be PTR plus 2? 2 locations away. How many bytes for 1 location? 4 bytes. So 2 locations means 4 plus 4? 8 bytes. So 8 locations away. So after this and this. So what is it? 508. And so that's correct. So what we so is that PTR plus I is a symbolic representation of the memory address, which is I locations away from the memory address stored in the pointer variable PTR. So that is what we so. Or we can represent PTR plus I as a numeric formula, this PTR plus size into I. Okay, for example, if it is 1, PTR is 500 plus 1 into 4. 4 is the size of a floating point number. So PTR plus 1 into 4 is 504. PTR plus 2 into 4 is 508. So you can see that use for value of this data type requires size number of bytes. Then it is PTR plus size into I. Okay, that's it. That is what I mean when I say it's a symbolic representation. Why is it called a symbolic representation? You are not just adding the numeric value I, but what you are adding? You are adding the numeric value I into size. Okay, so that's it. Now, one-dimensional array and pointer notation, let us recollect what we did. If you have an array declared like this, if you are directly enumerating the values in the part of declaration itself, no need to provide the size. It will be taken as 6. Okay, then an array will be created with 6 values like this. And recollect what is ARR plus I is the address of the ith element. ARR plus I is the address of the ith element. It's nothing but ARR plus I into size. If you look at this, 3. ARR plus 3 into size of an unsigned integer, 6. 3 into size is 2. 3 into 2 is 6. 6 plus 500 is 506. Okay. So what we, so we know that ARR plus I and ampersand ARRI are same. So both can be used and representing the address of the element at I. Now what is star of ARR plus I? If PV is a pointer variable, then what is star of PV? Yeah, use the content of PV as an address and take the value from there. So star of, if ARR plus I is the address of the element at I, then what is star of ARR I? The element at I. Okay, that's it. This is the element at 0, element at 1, 2, likewise. So what we discussed is that star of ARR plus I and ARR I both are same. Okay, these two are same. Okay. So, if you are using pointer notation, the address is ARR plus I and the value is star of ARR plus I. And if you are using array notation, the address is ampersand ARRI and the value is ARRI. Okay, and you can interchangeably use a pointer notation or an array notation to access a one-dimensional array. So now the next topic is to see how can you receive the address of an array using a pointer variable. So here is an example, and the interesting thing is this formal argument. So what is this formal argument? The name is PTR, which is declared as a pointer to what type? Unsigned integer. So what you can store in PTR? Yes, the address of any unsigned integer. And see what is passed is, what is passed is the array name. So what is the array name? Array name is this address of the first element in this array. So what is this array? This array is an unsigned integer array. So the first element is an unsigned integer and you are passing the address of that. So it's fine. And let us see how the execution progresses. And before that, this is an important thing. I am in this statement, I am accessing the element at I. Here using the array notation. So what is it? PTRI. Here I am using the pointer notation. These two are same that we know. Both these are representing the same. And what is it? It is the element at index I. So what I am doing in this statement, I am incrementing the value of the element at index I. Okay, I am interchangeably using the pointer notation and the array notation. Okay, purposely I use two different notations here. Okay, this is the pointer notation to access the element at I. This is the array notation to access the element at I. Now see how the execution progresses. The foo is invoked. So there are two data elements, an unsigned I, which is an index to the array, and an array of size 3 is created in memory. Okay, as a part of the declaration itself, three values are stored. Okay, it's getting stored here. And then it comes to this function call. So what is this function call? The function call transpose the address of the first element of the array. So PTR gets the address of the first element. What is it? 500. So PTR is 500. And there is an I in this instance also, which is unknown because it's not declared. And it comes, and you know that what is done by this function? It just increments the value at every position. So this will be 2, 3 and 4 after execution. And that is the execution. After execution, so 2, 3 and 4 is incremented. And the control returns and then it proceeds and prints. And if it prints, it prints the value of elements at 0, 1 and 2. Okay, that is what we do when we pass the address of an array to a function. But previously, before discussing pointers, we were using an array. And the next topic is to see the difference between that two. Okay, here what I did is I declared an array of size 100 and I am passing the address of this array to the function bar. And see, in bar, I am taking this as a pointer. Okay, let us recollect what we know about this now. So this is a pointer variable. This is a pointer variable where you can store the address of an arbitrary unsigned integer. And we know that PTR plus I or ampersand PTR I both represents the address of the element at I. This is the pointer notation and this is the array notation. And we also know that how the element can be accessed. Using the array notation, it is PTR I. Using the pointer notation, it is star of PTR plus I. And you must be careful about the index values. It must vary from 0 to size minus 1. The last point is very interesting. It says that if PTR points to the element at index I, then if you say PTR plus plus, it's again symbolic. It just makes the pointer pointing to the next cell in the array. Okay, next element in the array. That is, if PTR is pointing to index I, then PTR plus plus will make it pointing to index I plus 1. We will discuss an example. And now see the next slide. The only difference is that previously we had a pointer here, or you can have an array. This is what we did before we studied pointers, and both are same. Okay, both are same. Even here you can say BRR plus, because these are two different syntaxes to declare a pointer variable. Okay, this is again a point of variable. So that's the difference. You may be confused. Previously I said if you use a declaration statement like this, then you are declaring ARR as a pointer constant. Yes, yes. Which you cannot alter. It should always point to the first address of the array. But when you are declaring like this, in a function as a formal argument, this is a pointer variable. So you can assign the address of any element into that variable. You can increment that pointer variable or decrement that pointer variable. Okay, to make it more clear, let us discuss an example. The purpose is to understand what is PTR++. And here is an example. And before that, try to see what I am doing. I am passing the address of this array into this pointer variable. Okay, so PTR is initially pointing to what? The first element of the array. Okay, so I am just printing that element using star PTR. If PTR is 500, what is star PTR? It is 1. Okay, then what I do is I am not using any index. I am incrementing PTR++. This will make PTR point to this address. So PTR, if it is 500, PTR++ is 502. Then I print, go back and I print star of 502. Okay, then I again increment, I am placing it into this and I print, I increment this. Then I increment to this and I am checking this and this loop is going to terminate. Let us see how the execution progresses. So now you are into this statement, the function call is going to be executed. Yeah, the control jumps into that. I am not showing this tag, that's okay. So what PTR is getting? The PTR value is 500. It comes to this point. So what will be printed? Star PTR. What is PTR? 500. So what is star PTR? The content of 500. So what is it? 1. So 1 will be printed. Yeah. So now PTR++. So what is it? We know that PTR++, because PTR is now pointing to 500, PTR++ will make PTR pointing to this location. So PTR++, if you execute, this will become 502. Okay. Then it comes to this, it checks whether this is correct or not. What is star PTR now? PTR is 502 and star PTR is 2. 2 is not equal to 99, which is correct. So it goes back again into the loop and it prints the star PTR. Star PTR is 2 now, it prints. And then it needs to increment, 2 is printed, it needs to increment PTR. It is 502, it must point now to 504 if you increment. Yes, if you increment, it is 504. And it comes to this statement, it checks whether star PTR, PTR is 504, star PTR is 3. Is 3 not equal to 99? Yes. So it goes back again. So it prints star PTR. What is star PTR? It's 3. 3 is printed. And then it increments PTR. So it, PTR will become 506. Then it checks star PTR is not equal to 99. What is star PTR? You go to 506. What is it? 99. Is 99 not equal to 99? No, it's wrong. So that's the loop terminates and the program returns. Sorry, the function returns. And so that is this program. So what we saw is that PTR++ will make the pointer variable pointing to the next element in the array. Similarly, you can also use PTR minus minus. Don't use minus minus when you are already at the zeroth index. Okay. And don't use plus plus when you are already at the last index. So that you have to be careful about. So with that, I am moving to the last slide, which is an exercise for you. So write a menu-driven program with options to do the following on a one-dimensional array. Read elements is one option. You provide a function for that. Display elements, provide another function. Decrement the value of each element in the array. You provide it another function. In each of the function, you have to access the array using pointers. And in each function, you have to use a different way of accessing pointers. Maybe in one case you can use star PTR plus I, in some other case, in some other way, okay, that you think and implement. And that's all for today, and looking forward to see your solutions for the example problems given here.